Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Prahladan Iyer. I am Chief General Manager at Export Import Bank of India. I head the research and planning, research and analysis group of Exim Bank. I have a pleasure to welcome you all for this masterclass on impact of Union Budget on select sectors. It is indeed encouraging to see a number of participants joining us for the today's webinar. I just want to present a few logistics before we begin. At this time, all participants are only in the listen mode. Today's webinar, we have a presentation on this topic of budget analysis. If you have any questions or comments that you would like to share, feel free to send them to us through the questions and answers tab, which appear on your screen. We will respond to all the comments and questions after the presentation. We will also share a copy of the presentation with all the participants after the seminar is over. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be aware Exim Bank brings out research publications on various industry sectors and countries, as also macroeconomic issues of relevance to international trade and economy. In our effort to upscale the reach of our activities and to create a platform for discussion on topical issues pertaining to the Indian as well as the global economy, we launched this webinar kind of initiative. The platform has helped disseminate information emerging from Exim Bank's in-house research, as also facilitate discussion on relevant issues. Exim Bank considers organizing such seminars as part of its wider mandate of promoting and facilitating the growth of India's foreign trade. After several successful webinars last year we conducted covering topics related to exports, economy, and trade, we are happy to welcome you for this first seminar for the year 2020 to start with the budget, which is a topic of interest of today. The topic of today's webinar is extremely significant in the context of the present position of Indian economy. The economy has been undergoing a major overhaul in the past few years, with the decisive steps being taken by the Government of India and for ensuring inclusive growth, easing the business environment, and undertaking reforms with the aim of reviving agriculture, rural economy, MSMEs, and also the industrial sectors. In spite of various positive reforms that have been undertaken, the Indian economy witnessed a slowdown in the past year, attributable not only to the external factors, but also to tepid demand in the domestic economy. Given the limited scope of monetary policy in a situation of growing inflation, the revival of economy is critically hinging on fiscal stimulus provided in the union budget. The central theme of this year's budget is Aspirational India, Economic Development and Caring Society, with a focus on strengthening agriculture and allied sectors, rural economy, MSMEs, infrastructure, tourism, among others, while also focusing on important development goals such as wellness and social welfare. Today's webinar is an attempt to analyze various aspects of India's Union Budget 2021, and this should hopefully provide key insights on the topic to the industry, policy practitioners, research organizations, professionals, academia, among others. The webinar shall broadly cover key deficit indicators of the government, major measures announced in the Union Budget, impact on select sectors, as also the implications on exports. Let me introduce you to the speakers for today. Ms. Jahanwi, who will be the first presenter, she is an economist with Exim Bank. She has extensive experience in the analysis of international trade, economic policies, and also industry dynamics. Her research work has helped to provide key policy recommendations to central and state governments. She has also worked on institutional capacity building assignments of export finance in several African countries. We have another speaker, a young economist with Exim Bank, Ms. Neha Raman. She has worked extensively on trade potential mapping, country risk analysis, and also industry insights. She has co-authored articles on contemporary issues in the media and other publications. Neha Raman has provided key inputs in the area of debt sustainability analysis to internal and also the external stakeholders of the bank. Ladies and gentlemen, we sincerely hope that this platform will provide perspective on the topic to all the participants. We look forward to your questions as also your feedback on today's session. Thank you very much. I now invite my colleague Jahanwi to kindly begin this session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, and good afternoon, everybody. I'll just open my presentation. Okay, so once again, good afternoon, everybody. In today's presentation, my colleague and I would like to take you through the various facets of the Union Budget 2020-21 and outline its impact on various sectors of the economy as also on exports from India. I'll first begin with a brief overview of the fiscal deficit indicators in the budget. We will discuss what are the revenue sources, what are the major expenditure areas, and what has been the implications on the fiscal deficit. Thereafter, I'll discuss some of the major highlights of the budget, and then I would invite my colleague Neha for discussing the impact of the various initiatives and incentive schemes on the sectors. And finally, we will conclude with the likely impact of the various initiatives on exports from India. Let us first begin with the key deficit indicators. So this breakup, this is a breakup of all the sources of government revenue as also the areas of expenditure for the government. Now, if we compare the sources of revenues for 2020-21 from the budget of previous year, we find that the contribution of corporation tax to the government's coffer has reduced from nearly 21% in 2019-20 to 18% in 2020-21 budget. This is on account of the reduction in corporate tax rates, which we saw. One major impact on the revenue sources has been on account of the disinvestment announcements. As we know, the disinvestment announcements are projected to increase significantly to the tunes of nearly Rs 2.1 trillion during the upcoming financial year. And as a result of this, the non-debt capital receipts has witnessed a major jump. The non-debt capital receipts last year were also very high, but this year it has shot even further on account of the major disinvestment plans which are upcoming in the financial year 2020-21. The collection from income tax are expected to increase by nearly 14%. I'm talking about the growth rate. But if we see the share of income tax is also increasing from 16% to 17%. Now, this is in spite of the introduction of the new and simplified personal income tax regime, which will allow a reduced tax rate for those taxpayers who forego certain deductions and exemptions. In spite of that, income tax is expected to see a 1 percentage point increase. If we look at the expenditure areas, the biggest outlay once again is for state's share of taxes and duties, followed by interest payments. State's share is nearly 20%, while interest payments account for nearly 18% of the expenditure amount. Interestingly, if we compare this with FY19-20 budget figures, we find that the expenditure on subsidies, the share of expenditure on subsidies is going down substantially. This is largely on account of the reduction in subsidies in the fertilizer segment. Another noteworthy thing is the defense segment. The share allotted to defense is also going down. But if we see at absolute levels, then the allocation to Ministry of Defense has actually increased, and it is still the ministry which has received the highest expenditure allocation. So in spite of this reduction in share, the overall allocation to defense is still quite high. Now, coming to the fiscal deficit per se. Now, the importance of fiscal discipline cannot be overemphasized. And here we have tried to put some key deficit indicators for the government. Fiscal discipline is important because we need to ensure that each government pays for what it spends on. So if you look at the deficit indicators for the year, the revenue deficit for FY21 is targeted at 2.7% of GDP, which is higher than the revised estimate of 2.4% in 2019-20. The fiscal deficit is also targeted at 3.5% of GDP, which is lower than the revised estimate of 3.8% in 2019-20. Now, this fiscal deficit is this fiscal deficit targets which we have here is lower than what is there in 2019-20. But if we compare it with what the government had projected last time, so the budgeted fiscal deficit last time was 3.3%. We are currently expecting a revision and it is going to be 3.8%. The medium term target for 2020-21 was 3%. Again, we are overshooting that target. But this is necessary given the current conditions on the Indian economy. There is a need for fiscal stimulus because, as we are aware, the inflation in the economy is increasing, and as a result of which, to fuel aggregate demand, to revive the economy, to reverse the slowdown, we cannot necessarily depend on the monetary policy side. So fiscal stimulus is necessary, and this fiscal deficit targets which have been overshot is probably because of the recognition from the government side of the need for a fiscal stimulus in the economy. If we see the revenue deficit, it is expected to reduce to 0.4% of the GDP. While this might seem like a small number, but as per the FRBM Act, we know that by 2020-21, we're supposed to reduce this, I mean, absolutely eliminate this primary deficit to 0% of GDP. But even in 2020-21, we are expecting to see a 0.4% of GDP figure for primary primary deficit. Now, looking at the key highlights of the budget, the budget was woven around three broad themes. Aspirational India, which basically looked at aspects such as the standard of living of the people, the access to health, education, and better jobs, skill development. The second theme was that of economic development, focusing on aspects like industry and commerce and infrastructure, as also an increasing focus on technology, which is represented here through the new economy theme. The third theme was that of caring society. So there was a lot of focus on cultural, environmental, and such aspects, cultural aspects in the budget as well. And all these three are to be supported through a policy-driven good governance and a clean and sound financial sector. Now, these are important from the point of view of improving the aggregate demand in the economy. What we are seeing in the Indian economy currently is a very peculiar situation. Unlike previous times when we had supply side issues, now what we are seeing in the Indian economy is a demand side issue. Private consumption, as we are aware, has witnessed a slowdown in the recent period. And the first advance estimates of national accounts are out now. And the data suggests that the private final consumption expenditure in FY 2021 is expected to register a growth of 5.8% in 2019-20, which is a moderation over the figure of 7.2% during the fiscal period. Clearly, consumption has witnessed a slowdown, private consumption has witnessed a slowdown, and that is why the focus on aspirational India. So that is why we see a lot of schemes which are focusing on the agriculture sector, as we know, the PM Kisan scheme. Then there are several schemes for rural roads, such as the Gram Sadak Yojana, as also housing, such as the PM Awas Yojana. And there's also a lot of focus on education and skill development. This all is steered towards driving consumption demand in the economy, private consumption demand. Now, while consumption has witnessed a slump in the previous year, there has also been not much private investments. Investments have also remained subdued. So the gross fixed capital formation, which is indicative of investments in the economy, witnessed a less than 1% year-on-year growth in 2019-20, as compared to a growth of 9.8% in the previous fiscal year. So private investments also remain weak. In a bid to promote private investments, we saw the theme of economic development, which focuses on promoting investments in industry and commerce, channeling more investment in the infrastructure segment, as also catching up with the technology such as AI and preparing the Indian economy for a digital tomorrow. The government expenditure, which is a third important component of steering the aggregate demand and reviving the aggregate demand, also is set to increase on account of this third theme of caring society. So we saw a lot of allocations for social sector schemes. In some of the schemes, admittedly, the allocation has declined, but there are several new social schemes which has witnessed greater allocation during the year. So basically, private consumption, private investment, government expenditure all has witnessed some kind of an incentive from the budget. The fourth important aspect is, of course, exports, but we will come to that towards the end of our presentation. If we look at the key schemes, the allocations under the key schemes, we see that PM Kisan Yojana has received a major increase in allocation. There has been a 37.9% increase in allocation. And this basically shows that the focus of the government is now shifting towards a more progressive agriculture support strategy, which is more in lines with the WTO guidelines. So there is a shift from a price support mechanism to a more income support mechanism, which is basically under the ambit of green subsidies in WTO and would invite lesser eyes on the support which is provided by the government of India to the agriculture sector. Then a few of the schemes such as MNREGA and National Health Mission saw a dip in allocation, but there are several other social sector schemes where there has been an increased allocation, such as a Swachh Bharat Yojana that has received a considerable increase in allocation. Now, coming to the impact on select sectors, I would request my colleague Neha to briefly explain the impact of key initiatives on select sectors, and then we'll come back to what has been the impact on the fourth stimulant of aggregate demand, which is the export sector.
Thank you, Jahanwi. Good afternoon, everyone. We'll now look at some of the sectoral impact of the budget. We start with agri and allied sectors. Now, agriculture is one of the key focus areas under the theme of aspirational India. If we look at the allocation to agri and rural development sector as a whole, we see a 13% increase vis-a-vis the previous year. Now, increased spending on important schemes like interest subsidy on short-term farm credit and increased allocation towards dairy development, fisheries, and also in the irrigation program, the PM Krishi Sichai Yojana, that has received nearly 41% increase in allocation vis-a-vis the previous year. Now, these will collectively lead to an overall positive impact in the sector, especially the farm credit will improve in the short run, and also the expansion of micro irrigation, wherein the effective implementation could lead to nearly 3.5 million hectares of land being covered under the program. Now, these are positive impacts on the sector. Now, coming to the higher allocation to fisheries and dairy, these kind of indicate the government's efforts towards diversifying farmers' income. Fishery sector particularly has been on focus since the last budget itself, with the Matsya Sampada Yojana being launched. This year, there is a focus on setting up 500 fish FPOs and more than 3,000 new Sagar Mitras, with the target of raising fishery exports to 1 lakh crore by 24-25. Although these are positive steps and are likely to benefit the sector, however, most of these announcements involve structural changes in the agri sector, and therefore it may take time to have a meaningful impact on the sector overall. Again, implementation is a key monitorable aspect here. We move to the next segment or sector, which is BFSI. Now, starting with the equity support to infrastructure finance, a capital infusion of 10,000 crore into IIFCL has been announced in the budget. Now, this is likely to give a major boost to infrastructure finance in the country, and it can help in meeting the funding requirement of up to 50 to 60,000 crore in the infrastructure sector. There has also been an announcement of handholding for technology upgradation, R&D, business strategy for mid-sized companies. That is again a positive. Now, given the significant liquidity crunch faced by NBFCs. We believe that this year's budget has focused more on NBFCs rather than banks. No fresh capital infusion plans have been announced for PSBs this year, probably because most of the banks that have exited the PCF framework are now relatively better off and can access the capital market for their capital needs. So for NBFCs, this budget has provided some relief in the sense that the eligibility limit under the SARFAESI Act, the reduction of asset size and loan ticket size, is a positive for NBFCs. Also, the move to permit NBFCs to operate on TREDS platform, which was so far limited to NBFC factors only, and engage in invoice financing, these will give them major opportunities to extend their working capital loan to MSMEs. Though NBFCs are cost inefficient when it is compared to banks, but they can cater to segments that are not the focus of banks. So therefore, these announcements are expected to open new market opportunities for NBFCs. Also, now we come to the listing of LIC on the stock exchange. Now, this is likely to be the biggest IPO in the country and contribute significantly to the government's disinvestment targets. But the outcome depends largely on whether or not the divestment targets are met. Also, in this budget, there has been an announcement to infuse nearly 7,000 crore into three general insurance companies, which are the National Insurance Company, Oriental Insurance Company, and United India Insurance, so that they can maintain their solvency ratio. Now, this is a positive step, but in order to sustain, it is critical for the insurance companies to improve their underwriting performance in the medium to long term. Overall, the announcements in the BFSI sectors have been positive for the sector. We move to the next sector, which is electronics. Now, there is a brief mention about a new scheme for promoting manufacturing in electronics in India, which will be a key positive for this sector. Although the details of the schemes are yet to be available, we expect that these will primarily be production-related incentives that provide cost competitiveness for domestically produced electronic goods. We also expect that the new scheme is likely to replace MSIPS, which is the Modified Special Incentive Package Scheme, which is currently being reviewed by the government. Primarily, the focus of the budget announcement has been to promote domestic manufacture and reduce import dependence in the sector, which is a welcome step. Currently, we have a trade deficit in electronics to the tune of nearly $48.8 billion. So overall, the sector is expected to revive and receive a boost in the forthcoming years. We come to infrastructure now. So for the first time in several years, the overall infrastructure capex has fallen by 8% this year. So if we see, it has fallen to 4.7 lakh crore from 5.1 lakh crore in the previous financial year. So, and moreover, there has been a fall of 16% in the internal and extra budgetary resources of the government this year, which implies that there is a higher burden on budgetary support and a strain on government finances. Now, to achieve a GDP target of $5 trillion by 2025, India needs to spend about $1.4 trillion on infrastructure, which is nearly 100 lakh crore over this period. Now, in the recent announcement made by the Honorable Finance Minister in December 2019, there is a mention of a national infrastructure pipeline of about 102 lakh crore, which account by 2025, so which is nearly 15 lakh crore per year, that is annually. Of this, this year's budget has announced 4.7 lakh crore, which means that the remaining amount of the 15 lakh crores will have to be sourced from the states or the private players in the sector. Considering the limited number of private players and the low risk appetite of banks in this particular segment, private participation will remain a key challenge. Now, to that, this the tax exemption for sovereign funds to increase foreign investments for participation across infrastructure sector may prove to be beneficial in this regard. It will it may promote private players to from foreign investments to participate in infrastructure. Also, the capital infusion into IIFCL, which we just saw in the BFSI sector, is also likely to help in funding infrastructure projects to certain extent. Coming to specifics, we note that the allocation to urban development has fallen significantly by 22%, while the allocation to rural development has remained unchanged as previous year. This, by this I mean allocation to the Ministry of Rural Development. Now, lower spending on infrastructure could lower the chances of revival of the allied sectors such as steel and cement. But if we see the allocation to Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, there is a hike of 39%, which is likely to provide some impetus to the allied sectors related to road infrastructure. If we look at the Udaan scheme, so under the Udaan scheme, 100 more airports have been announced to be developed by 2024. This is in line with the vision of National Infrastructure Pipeline. Now, this is in addition to the 106 airports already awarded, which does seem to be a positive step. But if we look from the point of view of implementation, operationalizing these existing 106 airports is equally important as important it is to open new, start new airport projects. So therefore, implementation again here will be an important aspect. According to secondary data, we have noted that around 106 airports awarded earlier are non-operational due to lack of basic airport infrastructure. So again, infrastructure implementation is a key aspect that we have to focus on. Now, in the railways, again, the positive is that there is an increase in allocation to railways by 3%, but this remains short of the 3.8 lakh crore of annual investments required to reach the 50 lakh crore investment target by 2029-30. So again, that is a negative point here. In shipping, the customs duty reduction on very low sulfur fuel oils, which is IMO compliant, it has been brought down from 10% to zero, which is a positive for shipping because India is partly dependent on imported marine fuel for its bunkering needs. And the demand for it has increased ever since the IMO requirement of low sulfur fuel with effect from January 2020. So this is a step well in time and is positive for the shipping sector. If we look at logistics, the budget has also extended its focus to logistics and warehousing this year. Announcements of mapping and geotagging of agri-warehousing, cold storage, reefer van facilities by NABARD was made this year. Also, along with the proposal of creating an efficient warehouse at the block level or taluk level, in line with the warehouse development regulatory authority norms. The budget also announced that efficient warehousing will be made available with viability gap funding from the central government. And it also proposed a backward linkage, setting up of village storage schemes, which will be run by SHGs. Now, these will turn beneficial for good holding capacity for farmers and also to reduce their logistic cost. So the first point does remain positive for warehousing sector. Now, the second point is the impetus to cold storage through Kisan Rail and also the Krishi Udaan scheme. Now, efficient implementation of the schemes again remain a key monitorable aspect here. So India has an estimated capacity of 162 million tons of agri-warehousing, cold storage, reefer van facilities, etc. So Particularly cold storage segment, which is facing a shortfall of about 50% of the country's requirement, and also perishable goods, the loss of perishable goods, which are about 40% of the total agriculture produce. These aspects are likely to be met by the new announcements made. So another aspect that is to be monitored is the National Logistics Policy, which is supposed to be released soon. The draft logistics policy was announced in February 2019. So these policy measures are positive move towards the government's focus on reduction of logistics cost as a percentage of GDP. So more or less the segment is benefiting from the budget this year. We come to oil and gas. So oil and gas has received about 0.4 lakh crore of subsidies this year, of which majority is LPG subsidy, and the kerosene subsidies have declined substantially by 18.4%. So it is a positive move towards higher LPG consumption. So the proposal to extend national gas grid from existing 16,000 kilometers to 27,000 kilometers. Now this is again a positive step. This will ensure resolve the problems of last mile connectivity. It will also lead to it will also be beneficial for midstream segment. And it can also help transform the economy to gas-based economy. Capital outlay for the sector has increased by 57.2%, and the allocation towards the strategic reserves have increased by 600%. Both of these are positive for the sector, especially the strategic reserves will provide cushion against global supply disruptions in crude oil. Lastly, in this section, the customs duty on propane and butane. Basically, propane and butane are the the mixtures of two gases that are used in LPG. So these the customs duty reduction will benefit especially the non-domestic LPG segment, and it is likely to reduce the price of LPG in commercial LPG and industrial LPG segments. We come to textiles. Now the budgetary allocation for Tufts is this year is 54% higher than the previous year. It is a key positive for textiles. Unlike the last budget, this budget has given a couple of measures to promote textiles industry. So ATAFs, increase in allocation to ATAFs will ensure that there is fresh capex in the industry. So that is a key positive. Now the abolishment of anti-dumping duty on PTA. So PTA is a key raw material that is used in the production of polyester. So that will help the abolishment of anti-dumping duty will help the producers of man-made yarns to fetch raw material at competitive prices now. So that is again a positive for man-made yarn industry. Now the National Technical Textile Mission. So technical textiles have high demand and high potential, but India this market has been relatively underpenetrated for India. So this National Technical Textile Mission is proposed, which is important for the promotion of technical textile segment, which is a high potential and high demand sector. So the success of this mission is likely to reduce dependence on imports, and which are currently at $16 billion per year. So again, that is a positive for this sector. Budget allocation towards textile infrastructure has also doubled this year, almost doubled. So this will improve competitiveness. So again, that is a positive. We come to power and renewable energy. Now, power and renewable, the Ministry of Renewable Energy, New and Renewable Energy, has received a 48% increase in allocation, of which nearly 27% is for wind energy and 10% for solar power. Now, both of these are positive steps. Again, this will improve implementation of several schemes like solar park and rooftops and off-grid renewable energy programs. Also, the PM Kusum scheme has received a 1,000 crore allocation this budget. Although the scheme was introduced in the previous budget, this is the first significant allocation to the scheme. This is expected to boost the implementation of grid-connected agriculture pumps. Coming to tax rates of 15% on new power generation company for new power generation companies. Now, with this, what is likely to happen is that the equity IRR, which is the internal rate of return, is expected to. So the equity IRR is expected to improve, especially for new renewable energy capacities because of improved cash flows because of reduced tax rates. So this will encourage more investments in the power sector, and the benefits are expected to be higher in renewable energy space. And the proposal to replace conventional energy meters by prepaid meters. Now, these are also positive steps, like billing and collection efficiency will lead to reduction in aggregate technical and commercial costs, losses for distribution companies. The losses were currently around 21%. So these are expected to be reduced. So again, this is a positive step. Grid management and reduced manpower requirement due to digitalization will also reduce operational costs for DISCOMs. That is again a positive step. Now we come to other sectors. Now, mostly in these, we are concentrating on a few measures or certain customs duty reduction and their impact. Although tourism has been one of the focus areas under the theme of Caring Society of this year's budget, but the number of measures announced remained fairly limited. The allocation to Ministry of Culture and Tourism Promotion has increased, but the proposed development of new archaeological sites and museums, these are expected to boost domestic travel more than foreign travel. Also, although it augurs well for the tourism industry as a whole, the domestic travel will be more benefited than foreign travel. As a result, even the hotel industry is expected to partially benefit from this. Now, another important announcement was the INSAT exams to be held in Asian and African countries for foreign students. This is a positive step in the sense that this will promote education tourism. So that is a good point to begin with. In the gems and jewelry segment, if you notice that there are only increase in customs duty in certain items like precious stones, semi-precious stones, synthetic gemstones. Now, these will, of course, increase the import cost of gemstones and will in turn negatively impact the industry. Whereas there is also increase in customs duty on gold, platinum and palladium used for manufacture in semiconductors. Now, that although on one hand may increase the cost of gold imports, but then in India, the gold demand is price inelastic. So the impact on revenues of jewelry companies will remain marginal. Coming to steel and aluminium, again, this is a customs duty related measure. Reduction in customs duty in calcined pet coke, which is basically an input used in the steel and aluminium. This is expected to reduce the manufacturing cost, although only a small part of the overall cost will be reduced. Also, the increased electrification, as I mentioned earlier, in the increased electrification of railway lines up to 27,000 kilometers. Now, that is expected to help base metals, especially aluminium, and to also certain extent copper. In the paper segment, again, it is customs duty. Now, India is a net importer of paper and paper products, and nearly 50 to 60% of newsprint and 1/4 of coated paper in India are imported. So a reduction in duty will negatively impact the domestic manufacturer and affect their price competitiveness. Coming to pharma, there were no specific focus on pharma per se as a sector, but since there were healthcare programs that were introduced and especially the focus on TB elimination by 2025, also the expansion of Jan Aushadhi Kendra by 2024. So these are positively affecting the pharma sector in the sense that nearly 2,000 medicines will have higher demand now, and around 300 surgicals will have higher demand. So pharma will get positively impacted as the programs unfold. And finally, we come to auto and footwear. So auto sector also again had only customs related announcements. The basic customs duty on semi knockdown and complete knockdown form of electric vehicles has been hiked. Now, this is a positive step for the local manufacturer. Again, in the same lines, customs duty on completely built units of commercial vehicle, including electric vehicle and non-electric vehicle, have been increased, which is again positive for the domestic industry. However, the removal of social welfare surcharge on imports of commercial vehicle introduced in this budget will to some extent neutralize the positive impact of increasing customs duty. So that is one part. And finally, we come to footwear. Again, footwear has customs duty related announcements. Customs duty on footwear and parts of footwear and some leather have been increased. Now, footwear imports have been on a rise, especially from China. Now, increase in customs duty will obviously help in reduce competition from cheaper imports. Increasing customs duty on patent leather will also support the domestic manufacturer, and it will impact, but the impact will remain minimum as it is only a small part of the overall industry. With this, we come to the end of impact on sectors. Now, I'd like to invite Jahanwi again to take over for impact on exports.
Thank you, Neha, for that insightful presentation on the impact on sectors. Now, we'll quickly move to impact on exports before we start with the question and answers round. Before I begin with the impact of budget on exports, I would like to first give perspective on the scenario of exports in the country currently. So if you look at the overall exports during the April to December period, there was a marginal growth in the overall exports of 0.93% only. Now, this is including both merchandise and services. If you look at only merchandise, there has been a decline of nearly 2% year on year during the April to December period. Now, a lot of this can be attributed to the global slowdown. A lot of it could be due to the structural challenges which we have, the challenges with the manufacturing sector overall in the domestic economy. And what we see in the budget is that there has been a lot of initiatives, especially on the financing side, to improve the export scenario. I'll first begin with a scheme which has been announced. The scheme of rupees 1,000 crore has been announced, which would be anchored in Exim Bank and SIDBI. Financing and handholding support will be provided to companies, mid-sized companies in sectors such as pharmaceutical, auto components, and the strategy, I mean, this would be for technological upgradation of these companies, for R&D, for business strategy, for a host of purposes. Basically, the purpose of the scheme will be to create a set of globally competitive companies in India, which would in turn help propel the overall exports from the country. Another major thing which we noted in this budget is that there has been a hike in customs duty across several segments such as medical equipment, electronic components, mobiles, electric vehicles. And in all these sectors, we have certain domestic capabilities. So basically, this hike in customs duty will promote domestic production and also help build capacities for exports. This will also provide scope for value chain integration, especially in segments such as electronics, where global value chains play a very important role in promoting exports. Another scheme which has been launched is a One Product, One District program. Now, this is perhaps similar to the One Village, One Product approach, which was started in Japan, and several other countries have adopted this approach over the years. In fact, the state of Uttar Pradesh also has a similar scheme, but this scheme, which has been proposed in the budget, is specifically with respect to the horticulture sector. And this will provide basically an impetus to the agri and allied sector exports from the country, which has in fact not seen a very good growth over the past year. During the April to December period, in fact, if we see agri and allied exports, there was a decline of 6.6% in exports. So clearly this program for horticulture is expected to reap benefits for the sector. Then we saw a lot of schemes for the MSME sector. MSME currently account for some one-third to 40% of overall exports. And there was a lot of initiatives in this sector which we saw. One was, of course, the government announced subordinate debt to MSMEs, which will be provided by banks as quasi-equity and will be fully guaranteed through the CGTMSC. Then the restructuring of MSME NPAs, the timeline has been extended for another year. We also saw the GST Council taking a lot of steps over the past year for simplifying the GST processes. And the same has continued. It shall continue even forward because there are some issues which still remain and still remain to be sorted. Then an app-based invoice financing loan platform has also been started for MSMEs. And also there'll also be a full tax exemption of 3 years has also been announced for companies with turnover up to rupees 1,000 crore. So a lot of benefits for the MSME sector to provide stimulus to the sector. We also saw some developments on the export financing point of view. Low cost export credit is extremely important for export competitiveness. It enhances the competitiveness of exporters. And recognizing this, the government has launched the Niryat Rin Vikas scheme, the NIRVIK scheme, which will offer enhanced risk cover at competitive rates to exporters. We also saw some developments in the marine products, the fishery exports, as my colleague Neha has already explained to you, so I'll not delve deeper into it. The target has been set for fishery exports to some 1 lakh crore, which is very high. Currently, it is nearly only 48,000 crore. So achieving 1 lakh crore by 2024-25 is quite ambitious, but let's see how the programs which have been proposed are implemented. Then there were again a mention of the scheme for reversion of duties and taxes on exported products. As we know, the FM has already made announcements pertaining to such a scheme during her announcements in September 2019, when it was termed as remission of duties on or taxes on export product scheme, the RODTEP scheme, which is likely to replace the existing MEIS scheme, in a bid to make our export incentive structures more compatible to the WTO guidelines. The scheme is expected to be announced this year. And a digital refund under the scheme is proposed for exporters. So these are the broad sectors of broad areas of intervention which have been announced in the union budget. As I mentioned earlier, there have been measures taken on all the four fronts to boost private consumption, to boost private investment, government expenditure, as also exports. A lot will depend upon the implementation of the schemes and how they are taken up by the respective stakeholders. Now we will start with the questions. I'll ask Neha to join me for the question and answer round. Okay, so
We have a question from Mr. Raju Kumar Chaurasia. The interest expenditure is more. Does government should look into this? Can you explain effect of it in inequality of income? Of course, as I mentioned during my presentation also, interest expenditure forms a very substantial portion of the expenditure of the government currently. Nearly 18% of the expenditure is on interest payments, which is very high. And what this basically does is that as I mentioned earlier, every generation should spend what it can earn. When you have a greater interest burden, you're taking away the opportunity from future generations. That is why we like to keep fiscal deficit at lower levels, at near to the 3% range. And as we have also mentioned in the FRBM Act, we want to take the primary deficit in India to nearly 0%. But unfortunately, there has not been much progress on that front, because it is also a fact that the economy needs fiscal stimulus, and to revive the troubled sectors, we have to increase our fiscal expenditures. We have a question here from Mr. Nandan Trivedi, who is saying that, I think this budget is novel due to the integration of assemble in India to make in India. I think that is a very good coining of term, assemble in India. This is more from the perspective of electronics. As we know that in electronics, a lot of the exports which happen are through global value chains. And we have actually seen a lot of focus, not just from the customs point of view, but also from the schemes which have been announced. The focus on electronics is indeed increasing. And assemble in India need not necessarily be a bad thing, because that is how you integrate in the global value chains, and that is how you enhance exports in certain segments such as electronics. We have a question from Ambrish. Does it have any effect on exports? And there's another question. What is impact on dairy production doubling? There have been several initiatives in the agri and allied sectors, which is expected to boost exports from the agri and allied sector, which we have already covered in our presentation today. There's a question from Avni Agarwal. When shall we expect new FTP? Unfortunately, we at Exim Bank will not be aware of that. What will be the status of MEIS? As I also mentioned in my presentation, MEIS will eventually have to go, because it has been challenged, and we cannot keep WTO incompatible subsidies, because it will then attract a lot of international sanctions on us probably. So we cannot keep MEIS with us for long, and the FM has time and again announced the remission on duty schemes, which is going to come next year, and it will be more compatible to the WTO norms. Although the benefits under the RODTEP scheme will probably be lower than what is currently being offered under MEIS, and that is why the government is now focusing on other incentive schemes also, which are probably more linked with production rather than exports. That is why the scheme for the scheme which was announced for electronics sector, or the 1,000 crore scheme which has been anchored in Exim Bank, all these are initiatives which will help promote manufacturing, which in turn will help exports. We have a question on how this budget will impact on export of construction machines. Any special incentives? Construction machines, we did not see much incentives there. We did see in agri equipments and machinery, though, there has been some positives there, but nothing per se on the construction machinery segment. Does this budget boost Exim Bank funded projects? Exim Bank's funding through the proposed scheme of 1,000 crore is expected to benefit exporters, and that is one place with which we are expected to increase our contribution to exports. I think we can take one last question before close for today. Any indication for construction companies working abroad, any incentive?
Unfortunately, there has been nothing much for project exports, which has been announced in the budget.
You may, I don't think we can take any more questions right now, but you can email your questions, if any, to ccg@eximbankindia.in. We'll be also emailing you a copy of the presentation. So, also your feedback, we would await.
See you again for the next masterclass. Thank you very much.